Okay, why don't we get started? So
Sounds good.
thank you. Yeah, so I guess we can do this as, you know, like in talk shows. You're the interviewer, the whoever political figure who gives blurry answers to straightforward questions. I think that's this is probably the model. Anyway, so thank you everybody for joining. And I know some of you, some of the names here, but mostly I don't know, which is great. This webinar, the point of this webinar was to hopefully relieve some of the confusion about what we are, what our goals are, how we correspond and interact with ViewPathDB, which was recently brought back online, which is, I think, it was a very good development, and in general, who we are, what our plans are, and so on. So I am Anton Nikrutenko. I'm at Penn State. I've been professor here since 2003, so for quite some time. I'm the PI of the Galaxy project that was running here since about 2005. So it's going to be actually 20 years old next year. When we started this project, we applied for a U24 program, which was listed by NAID. And this program was about creating one of the BRCs, so Bioinformatic Resource Center for pathogens. And so we were one of the awardees, and our plan was to develop a computational framework which would allow people to do large-scale analysis on top of what was offered by other existing BRCs. So we were funded relatively recently. So the website that I'm gonna show you is about 3 weeks old. So please pardon the dust. It's gonna take us some time to get to the to what we actually want to do, and we want to do quite a bit. So today I'm going to explain who we are, what the team is, what our long-term plans are. I will show what you can do now, and hopefully we'll have time for questions, although given the fact that we have already, you know, close to 100 people soon, I don't know how we're going to organize this, but we'll see. Maybe we'll take the questions via chat and so on. So I will, hopefully I'm sharing the screen, which is the brc-analytics.org. That's the website from which everything will be going. So this project is spread across five sites. So there are five PIs. I am one of them. There's the other institutions which are involved in this is Johns Hopkins. So the Galaxy team is actually spread across multiple institutions, but in the US, two primary sites are at Penn State and at Johns Hopkins. There it's Mike Schatz's lab. Galaxy also has substantial footprint in Europe. There's a constellation of Galaxy instances, one in the US, one in Europe, and one in Australia. And there are lots of regional instances as well across the country. So it's a big project. So that's two PIs. Another group which is involved here is the group of Max Hostler. This is UCSC Genome Browser. So this is University of California, Santa Cruz. And maybe Genome Browser is not that well known in eukaryotic pathogen community, but that's certainly one of the world's premier resources for example, if you're dealing with human or mouse data. So it's well designed and positioned infrastructure to deal with the problems that we're going to have in the space of eukaryotic pathogens, vectors, and hosts. It's a good platform for this. The fourth PI is Sergei Kosakowski-Pont from Temple University, and he is the developer of the HiFi system. So HiFi is a platform for doing molecular evolution types of analysis. For example, this finding genes under different selection regimes. So this is one of the areas of this project, which will get to probably within a year or so, because it relies on our ability to generate alignments across genomes. and this is one of our plans. So we actually want to, one of our substantial foci here will be comparative genomics. I think if you used ViewPathDB, you probably are familiar with orthology plots. And so this is along the lines of what we are going to do, but we're going to do it on a whole genome scale. And the fifth institution, which is a part of this, is Texas Advanced Computing Center. This is part of the University of Texas system, but Tech itself is one of the big, if not the biggest, supercomputing center in the US. So many of you heard about perhaps private clouds, you know, Amazon, Google, Microsoft, but there are also public clouds, which were specifically designed for research. And there is a number of supercomputing centers like this. There's TAC, there's Pittsburgh Supercomputing Center, Indiana University, University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, University of San Diego, Oak Ridge Lab. So these are all very well run and maintained sites, which essentially provide public compute. These are resources designed for us, for people who do data analysis. And they were historically used heavily in things like, you know, physics, physical sciences, engineering sciences. But as biology becomes more and more data driven, they're essentially ideal resources for doing high scale types of analysis. What I mean by high scale types of analysis, for example, if you're doing, you know, population level studies of Plasmodium, for example, when you have samples across thousands of sites, multiple individuals, so these types of large data sets. So I need to keep myself on track so I don't go off the subject. So these are the sites. So it's essentially Galaxy Team, browser, the iFi, and all of this is built on top of Tech infrastructure. I should say that we do not limit ourselves only to Tech resources. We also run some of the jobs. So it depends on what types of analysis we're doing. For example, if we're doing large genome assemblies, they go to some resources. If you're doing smaller jobs, they go to other resources. The bottom line here is that it's essentially a constellation of battle-tested projects, and this is all built on top of the public, well-established, high-performance computing infrastructure. So in our opinion, this is how science should be done and should be open, and it should be run on public resources. So let me talk about roadmap. Again, please kind of bear with me here. We started this project effectively started on July 18. So the website is about 3 weeks old. It will be evolving quite rapidly. Actually, before I jump to this, let me do something here. There should be a... Okay. What I wanted to make sure you know is that, so there are these notes. There are, it's a carousel, which alerts you to things that are happening. So of course there is a note about the webinar today. We also would like to hear from you, because ultimately the roadmap for this project will be guided by what you need. And so if you want to get involved and have a say in how this works, please use this get involved button. This will get you to a form. If you want, you'll give us your email address and we'll be contacting you. And this, the fact that this is a very new resource, is on one hand, we don't have much yet, we're building it, but at the same time, because it's the beginning, it's the sort of a universal ancestor of whatever's gonna happen from that point, we're pretty free in terms of design choices that we can make. So the earlier you get involved, the more influence you will have. And another thing is, if you're on this site, there is Galaxy Academy, which starts on Monday. although this project is not really about Galaxy, but Galaxy will be one of the facets of this project. It will be essentially an analytical platform, which you will be used to do lots of analysis, whether you know or don't know that it's done by Galaxy. And this event, it's a week, it's a global event. It's done across the world, and it's done in such a way that we have instructors from different time zones. So if you're, for example, in South Africa, there will be somebody in that time zone. If you're here in Pennsylvania, there will be somebody in that time zone. And it covers a wide range of topics. It does not specifically cover topics which are related to eukaryotic vectors, pathogens, and hosts. But you know, ultimately, the workflows that we're going to be using, such as transcriptomic, variant discovery, epigenetic workflows, and so on, they're generic. They're the same. They work equally well for eukaryotic pathogen as they do for viruses, bacteria, and things like that. So this is a good resource to note. Back to roadmap. So our plan was, first, we have the database that VuePathDB maintained. And of course, VuePathDB is back online. So that's fantastic, because a lot of the people who used to do analysis in a certain way, for example, look at the gene pages, can continue doing that. Our point is to initially have data for all the genomes that were originally in VuePathDB, and try to extract as much information from this database so we can retain most of the additional data that VuePathDB had. Of course, VuePathDB was based on the same reference data that we all use, the reference data that goes from resources like NCBI, for example, but they had additional data sets, they had additional tracks, and we will see if we can port those as well. One thing I need to mention is that although I just mentioned the five sites which are involved in this project, we are also very closely work with NCBI, in particular with NCBI Comparative Genomics Resource and with NCBI datasets. And this is, again, we kind of are benefiting each other here. I mean, and I think NCBI is really eager to adopt some of their features, such as, for example, their gene pages to what people need. And of course, we're also trying to adopt to what they have. So this is very close collaboration. All our development meetings involve NCBI participants. Okay, so one of the first things is to try to import as much as of VuePathDB data as possible. The next step is harmonization of data. So VuePathDB had 785 data sets. We have most of them. There are some issues related to exact versioning of genomes. For example, some of the genomes that VuePathDB had may be older, or they have different versions, because you know there's a lot of confusion whether to use GeneBank IDs or RefSeq IDs. And so we're trying to go through all of this to resolve that. And harmonization is data is essentially trying to pull all the background genome data plus all the annotations that come with them. The next step will be integrating a Galaxy into this framework so that you can run analysis easily. For example, if you do experiments in your lab where you're generating RNA-seq data, or you run experiments where you want to know how your particular strain is different from other reference strains. So if you want to identify variants and you want to know whether these variants have functional effects or not, experiments of cheap-seq cut-and-run type, if you want to assemble new genomes, if you want to perform whole genome alignments, if you want to do protein folding experiments with things like AlphaFold, this all will be there. So perhaps the fundamental difference between what we are going to do here and what VuePathDB was offering is that we allow more on analytical side. you can do a lot of things yourselves. I can see that maybe some can be terrified for this because, you know, bioinformatics is whatever. For some reason, people sometimes are scared of this data analysis. And again, write this in the comments. Again, get involved so you can tell us that perhaps we're not thinking straight. But in my opinion, if you can do experimental work, you can definitely do computational work as well. Because, you know, many of us became computational people because we cannot do experimental work. That's the secret. It's much more complicated. So I think if we get our documentation and our training materials right, you will find that a lot of these black boxes, things that perhaps you were afraid of, I know, doing, you know, single cell RNA-seq on something, or quantifying, you know, gene expression, or figuring out what the variants are, you will find that they're, it's doable. And that's the difference, is that we're going to allow much more analysis for you to do. And all of this will be done in parallel with developing various types of training. And the way we're going to develop training will be along what we do with Galaxy right now. There is a dedicated framework. It's called Galaxy Training Network. There will be a section here dedicated to BRC Analytics. And you can see what we will have there. For example, I can give you, for example, in case of transcriptomic examples. So there will be detailed tutorials. How do you do certain things given your input data, whether you do bulk RNA-seq, whether you want to discover a new transcripts, where you want to do expression counts on genes. And these things are hands-on. So we usually give a lot of background information, you know, sort of how things work. And then we provide sample data sets that you can import into a Galaxy instance, and you go step by step and you actually run analysis yourself. And again, I mentioned Galaxy Training Academy, which will be happening next week. It will use these materials. So there are special tracks, for example, introduction to Galaxy, single cell transcriptomics, analysis of COVID data, lots of different things which will be incorporated in this training academy. So briefly, how would this sort of work? So what we have right now, again, it's minimalistic because it's 3 weeks old. One of the difficulties that I see us dealing with is that, you know, some of you who are on this Zoom call, you will look at this today and you will have that sort of a mental static image of what it was. And if you don't look at this again, say for half a year, you would assume that things don't change. So this is a very fast moving target. Our first release, sort of a minimal functionality that we want to have will be somewhere around October 15, maybe not exactly on October 15, but within this framework. And again, the information about this will be on this website. So it's a moving target. So please come back, look at it again at some point, and please ask questions. How you ask questions, there are also help channels that we created. Maybe Scott, while I'm doing this, can you put the link to the discourse into the chat so people know where they can ask questions?
Sure, that's a good idea.
So right now, for example, you work on Plasmodium. So first of all, let me explain what this page is. So this page is our attempt to replicate all our organisms that were in ViewPathDB. It almost achieves this goal. So the ViewPathDB has 785. We have 744 here. We're missing some for the reasons I explained. There is some unclarity about which versions to use and things like that. But let's suppose you work on Plasmodium. So you have various filters here. This will again evolve. I think some of the information that we're currently showing here may not be, so we'll add more fields here. It might not be entirely understood by all people, but essentially right now we are displaying statistics on how good these genomes are. So, you know, if genome has 14 chromosomes, that means, well, that's what you would expect. That means that it's probably a decent assembly. So right now, what you have here is, if you click on Plasmodium, if you click on the species name, you will get to NCBI taxonomy page. This is helpful because it shows you for this taxon what genomes are available in general. And so there is sort of one reference genome, which is a gold standard from NCBI standpoint, but there are obviously other assemblies. They might not have the same level of quality. They might not have the same level of annotation. And by annotation, I mean where genes, promoters, repeats, variants are. So that kind of information hooked up on the sequence. So going back to the to our view, and so we have three buttons here. One of them is, if you click on this, you're going to go directly to NCBI datasets for this assembly. And here, that's the place where you can get to gene pages. For example, this is a gene page for that particular falciparum gene, the 3D7 gene. You will see, of course, that it doesn't look the same as the gene pages that you used to look at PewPathDB. So it's in VuePathDB, as far as I remember, there were 13 categories or more. It included transcriptomic data. It included phenotypic scores. So if they were available, of course, for this ortology and so on. But we are going to, NCBI actually already pre-computes a lot of this. And so the question is, how we format this, how we display this. And again, this is why I urge you to get involved. You need to tell us. I'm gonna go back to BRC Analytics again. So that was the NCBI button. There is also a UCSC Genome Browser. You can go there. In this case, you will get a browser view. It will be, perhaps looks different from the JBrowse view that you used to see in on VuePathDB, but it's the same thing. It's just doesn't have all the same tracks yet. I should tell you that one of the people you see on this call, Scott Kane, actually was spent considerable fraction of his life working on JBrowse. So I think there will be likely JBrowse 2 available here as well for people who, for some aesthetic reason, prefer one versus another. But it's all essentially it's the same thing of displaying something on a single coordinate system. And so from the browser, you can, again, you can pick genes. And if you click on that gene, you will get to UCSC gene pages. Now, if you look at this, you might not be particularly impressed because, again, at this point, it does not have all that same information that you used to have on VuePathDB. But to start with, this page will be linked directly to the pages that NCBI provides. So at least it will be kind of easy to switch. And ultimately, it will all the custom information that we will be able to grab from VuePathDB database will be here. And we will ultimately allow things like ability for you to edit annotations. And all the browsers, and of course, UCSC Genome Browser as well, supports custom tracks. So if you want to upload your data and visualize it here, you can do that. And via some mechanism which we sort of yet to define, but it's already defined by UCSC. Some of these custom tracks can be promoted to community tracks, which will be seen by everybody. And this is again where one of our hopes is that obviously we cannot be experts in biology of all these things. So one of our key goals right now is to go through, so UPathDB of course was a constellation of various communities, of Plasmodium community, of fungal community, of host community, vector community, if to build some kind of a review mechanism around this. So for example, these tracks can be reviewed. And I also mentioned that we would like to start generating whole genome alignments. Of course, it depends on the quality of some genomes. And actually one of the sad things about, I think, eukaryotic pathogen research is that the quality of the genomes here is maybe not always that high. I mean, it's a problem not only in this domain, but also in other domains. But of course, sequencing is becoming cheaper, and hopefully this will improve. And actually, one of the specialties of this team is genome assembly. So if a good new data set will be generated, then we will supply the best practices for genome assembly given different technologies and different goals. Okay, so we're at half an hour. Going back here. And so I talked to you about clicking here gets you to taxonomy, clicking here gets you to NCBI datasets, clicking here gets you to UCSC genome browser. And finally, if you will be clicking on analyze button, you will be able to do different types of analysis in the context of this genome. So for example, in this case, we're talking about falciparum 3D7. And so a list of workflows that we're working on to make available in the nearest future is variant calling. And this variant calling will be for diploid and haploid cases, or to be more precise, for diploid and for mixture cases. So for example, if you're dealing with Anopheles, for example, that's a diploid organism. So you need to run a diploid pipeline. If you're dealing with haploid, especially with mixtures, you will be using the haploid workflow. There will be documentation explaining what the differences are. Transcriptomics workflows will be two big categories: the single cell type and the bulk type. And for bulk type, there will be variation across from whether your goals are quantifying expression or discovering new transcripts. There will be a regulation workflows for analysis of CHIP-seq, ATAC-seq data, these kinds of data sets. Assembly is going to be a kind of a special set of workflows because assembly, when you're assembling new genomes, so it cannot really be associated with an existing reference. And so that would allow assembly from Pacific Biosciences data sets, from Oxford Nanopore data. Of course, you can always do assembly from short reads, but don't do it if you can avoid that. We also gonna have workflows for doing genome alignments. So you will be able to take, for example, entire genomes of several, say, Anopheles species and align them. Again, meaningfulness of this analysis relies on quality of genomes ultimately. And my understanding of, for example, Anopheles genomes is that there's probably one or two good ones. And it sort of gets progressively worse. But again, it's a question of time. And there will be protein folding workflows specifically using Collab Fold, which is it's a system built on AlphaFold, but it just makes structure prediction faster. Let me look at my notes to make sure that I don't forget anything. It's on iPad, and I can't seem to enter my PIN correctly. So just give me a second here. Success. This is a kind of a quick overview. So at this point, we can maybe switch to questions, but let's figure out how we're gonna do that.
Well, so I have several questions. Let's see, I could pick some and see if you have any good answers. Let's see. So here's somebody who says, at some point, coming from the malaria community, many users of these data are not computational experts, but want to query the data with common language to ask simple questions like about specific mutations or predictions distilled from large genome data sets. How will you address this major user community?
So if I understand correctly, you want to have some kind of a large language model build on... Is the question about AI-assisted question answering in this case? If that's the case, then the question I'll kind of fire back at you is that this, of course, is possible, but what do we train it on? Now, this can be trained on all the corpus of literature in falciparum, that can be, or whatever other species of plasmodium you're studying. So that is possible, and there is a project inside Galaxy for doing AI-assisted guidance on how to do analysis and how to interpret the results. So I'm not sure. So yes.
Okay. Let's see. Here's another one. How will you build or acquire new data? What is the strategy? Only what is public, or will you work with the community support and find these resources to share with the community?
It's a great question because the reason why, I guess the question is, suppose you generated a new genome sequence, which is not an NCBI yet, and you want to make it available for others to do analysis on. This is why we have two ways to distribute genomic, to access genomic data. One of these ways is official way via NCBI references, but another way is that in UC, for the genome browsers, it's easy to build genome browsers out of anything. And so there will be a mechanism to build browsers for, so it's sort of a like preprint server for genomes. So you will be able to buy, to build browsers for example, new data sets. And once they become official at NCBI, of course, we'll migrate them there. But it's flexible enough that, yes, you will be able to do that. That's one of the main reasons why Santa Cruz UCSC Genome Browser is part of this effort. And I also mentioned that, you know, we don't have to be restricted to that browser. There are other browsers that we can use for that. Perhaps my answer is too browser-centric, but that's how I see this at this point.
Well, that actually so that leads to another question, which is, what is your definition of data set? It sounds like you're talking about genomes, which is a pretty narrow definition.
Genome is a canvas. So there are many types of data sets. We have genomic data sets. So genomic data sets, ultimately, you know, they come from something genomic. So they have, that's the canvas. There are, of course, other data sets in biology. And I think that biology going forward, so right now sequencing dominates biology, but I think in the near future, you will see imaging dominating biology. So if you're talking about imaging data, I don't know, from cryo-EM or some other microscopy types, then that would require hooking different data resources to this project? Again, it's in principle all pluggable, but do you have any examples of what you, I don't know, can I kind of ask them back, and is there a way to?
Not really, other than that people can ask additional questions. Let me scroll down towards the bottom and see if because I think the person who asked that was, I think it was anonymous. I don't see anything yet, but we'll see what happens. But yeah, there were a few questions about like data types. You know, this will you only host whole genome sequence data, or will there be other data types? There's also somebody asked about clinical isolate database for the different taxa as well. So there are questions about what sort of data types we'll be using, incorporating.
I don't know what is meant by data types here, whether it's.
Well, I think it comes back to like, what was it? The one asked a very specific question, which was clinical isolate database. So that's, I mean, that is a very, that's a very specific.
Clinical isolate data, I presume, refers to, for example, strain isolates, or for example, variants of a particular strain isolates for a particular pathogen from a population. So like, you know, COVID samples, for example, or malaria resequencing studies from somewhere. These are just VCF files. So these are essentially just a variant file. So yet another example of genomic data. These are coordinates of variants across the genome. The question here is that whether this data is control access or not, because if it's de-identified data and it's publicly available without you needing to go through the hoops such as dbGaP authorization, for example, then that's obviously not a problem. If it's a control access data, that's a completely different question, because then we're in the immediate future, which I mean, this year or two, I don't think we're planning to get to the point where we allow access to, where we work with, where we make the system available on controlled access data. But we have a parallel project, which is called Anvil, which is funded by NHGRI, where essentially the plan is to allow similar types of analysis, but for protected data sets. So I think once we perfect this project for at least for open data, I don't think it will be that difficult to transfer it behind that sort of a safety perimeter and to apply this to controlled access data as well.
Right. Let's see. So there's a few people that have commented things along the lines of about what was great about, and continues to be great because they are existing again, about ViewPathDB was that, all of the data was basically in one place. There's not really a question associated with that, but I guess it's more of a comment. I sympathize with that, that point of view. One person did ask if we would have all the variant data that was also available in ViewPathDB, and I think the answer to that is yes. If the data was there, we should be able to have access to it as well. Let's see. Here's an interesting question: how you leverage the biology expertise of the community that is a critical part of the use and providers of these data? There are a couple of questions that were along those lines. Somebody else commented that, presumably we don't have, and I think you alluded to this as well, is that we don't have all of the expertise in all of these taxa, because we're not. I consider myself kind of a generalist, so I definitely don't. And so basically the question is, how will we leverage the community in that regard?
Building community will be, it's easy to say building community will be one of our priorities. It certainly will be one of our priorities. In order to build community, you need to make something that is usable. because you need to have people at least have some desire to go to your resource. So I think our plan along those lines is to concentrate on a few well-defined use cases, and we need help from you on that. Again, get involved. To attract a substantial user base and form community based on that. It's easy to say, however, we have experience in that. This is how Galaxy project runs. It's not a single PI led for many years. I mean, I personally have no control over this for quite some time, and that's good. Same thing with Galaxy Training Network. It's a community. So I hope by not being too arrogant, actually by not being arrogant at all, and by trying to incorporate as many opinions as possible, which can be difficult, we'll try to win enough of you that this will kind of fall in place. Again, I want to be very humble here. I have obviously strong views on how this is supposed to be, but you can change these views. And my goal is, again, not to make things utterly complicated in the beginning and just figure out what kind of actual analysis you want to do, make them really straightforward and go from there. So this is why we have this webinar. We want to have these webinars fairly regularly, so you know what the change is. I was thinking about once every 2 weeks. Maybe it's too early, maybe it's too frequently, but we'll announce that. We'll figure this out, partially based on your feedback. So we have a kind of an unofficial scientific advisory board. I mean, our grant specifically does not require us to create an SAB, but SAB is a scientific advisory board, but we want to do that. And at this point, it's a little plasmodium heavy. So we actually want to, so if you are from other ViewPathDB communities, so specifically, let me share the screen again. So if you are, if you know somebody from all these communities, let us know. So either email us directly or use the discourse site, which Scott put the link to, because we need to form essentially, we need to form 12 SABs, you know, from PlasmaDB people, from ToxaDB people, from all of these, or at least, you know, one or, you know, two or three people who can do us that we're doing really stupid things, and that's what we really should be doing in these domains.
Okay, so let's see. I'm trying to. There was somebody who asked about assembly. So it said there are a lot of services, for example, through Malaria Gen, PF 7 Plus, et cetera, that already use best practice for genome assembly, et cetera. How will this distinguish from these already existing services?
I don't know what these services are. I need to look at them. But yeah. Assembly is a moving target. And for example, we are involved as a project, not as a BRC, but we're involved in large scale efforts, for example, on a virtual genome assembly, or there is a big efforts on sequencing everything. So, you know, Darwin Tree of Life, many of these projects, and it's a moving target. If you want to get a good assembly, you need good data. So you need to have appropriate coverage. You need to have as long reads as possible. And I don't think that the resources that you mentioned, although I don't know this, I need to look at it, but I don't think there is a turnkey solution, for example, for assembling genomes from ultra long ONT reads. I mean, the tooling for this is evolving. So things like Virco, for example, Virco Assembler, that's a very good assembler, but it's not something you want to play at home with. So it's an evolving target, and we are, I'm not saying me, but the people on that project are expert in this. So perhaps the resources that you mentioned have best practices, but will these be best practices next year? And so on. So it depends. I cannot answer this question directly because I don't know what this other thing does. If you send me a link, I'll be able to look at it. But the things that we will be offering will be best practices for PEG bio hi-fi reads, for ultra long Oxford nanopore reads, and these types of assemblies will, especially in, at least in the case of deployed organism support phasing. So you'll be able to assemble both haplotypes, which will be interesting in species like Anopheles.
All right. Here's one. This is one limitation of FungiDB, was the slow incorporation of new data, such as transcriptomic data. Will you be able to do this quickly?
We need guidance. So you, specifically the person who wrote this question, click on Get Involved Now, because you're from FungiDB. We want to talk to you tomorrow. Well, tomorrow is Saturday, so maybe on Monday. But please, because...
I'll probably check my mail tomorrow.
Because it's... again, this list that we have, you know, 744 genomes, there is nothing divine about number 785. This was just the initial set of genomes in the ViewPathDB. We're not restricted by any of this. So if you want to incorporate new data for existing genomes or new genomes, we just need to know that. It's just a question of hooking up the right browser, ensuring that, you know, NCBI references are there and going from there. So as easily as we have 744 genomes, we can have 7,440. And that's the goal, ultimately.
Yeah. Let's see. I feel like we obviously have bounced around this a little bit, but it says, what's the take now that ViewPathDB is back on? And somebody followed up to that and said, I'm also wondering this, especially how sustainable the now back again ViewPathDB is. Well, I don't know the answer to that. And also BRC Analytics. The message on ViewPathDB website is a bit scary. And I sympathize.
I have good interactions with David Roos, who is the PI on the ViewPathDB. I think we actually knew each other for quite some time. And if you used ViewPathDB, you probably know that it actually had Galaxy. It was not connected to us, but it was there. So I don't know what the sustainability of ViewPathDB is. And initial design of our project was complementary to ViewPathDB. We wanted to provide analytical platform on top of ViewPathDB. And so we're still going to do that. Our goal is to enable you to do as many analysis using best tools as possible. It's just what we are also doing right now is we're trying to direct you to, we're trying to provide at least reasonable replacement for the same type of data. But in principle, we can be completely complementary to what ViewPathDB does. And a good question there is that I think going forward, it would be great, especially if ViewPathDB sustains itself, to actually, in fact, do this one-to-one mapping, meaning if you go to this page, for example. So I see absolutely no problem why we cannot have ViewPathDB button here, and ViewPathDB having a button sending you there. So you go to ViewPathDB, you look at your gene pages. But then you have this RNA-seq data set that just was published, you know, in Nature Pathogens. I don't know if such a journal exists, but anyway, and you want to reanalyze it. So you look at your stuff in ViewPathDB, and then you go here, you put the IDs of these short read data sets, you run transcriptomic workflows, you get transcript counts, you visualize them in a browser, and that browser also has ViewPathDB tracks. That's sort of the ideal view of the world. And
yeah, and not only that, actually somebody asked a question about, you know, finding specific information about specific genes. So for instance, if you do some analysis at BRC Analytics and it results in a gene, you know, a gene or a list of genes that pop out of whatever analysis you do, I certainly could imagine one end result of that would be that would be linked directly to the gene page that corresponds at ViewPathDB. So the, you know, it's that integration makes a lot of sense. Yeah.
The difficulty here, of course, is figuring out that we're apples to apples, oranges to oranges, that genome assemblies are the same. That's, you know, I it's not a secret to most people on this call. Most of the problems in genomics are absolutely stupid. Like, you know, the versions don't match, or do you count nucleotides from zero or from one, or, you know, however you call your strands, plus or minus, or Watson or Crick, you know, it's all, it all comes down to this.
One person said she just, he just found a training link to One Health.
Yes.
That it looks neat, and said, can we expect more like that for other organisms?
Absolutely. I think you can plug in your organism in there right now. So just modify the training that you have here. Just use a different reference. And again, if you have bandwidth for this training on next week, it's more than us. Again, this is why I emphasize community. All this training that you see, for example, in One Health, that's not us. That's a framework that we all develop. But in fact, some of this training, for example, is developed probably by Wolfgang Meyer or these people who are from the Galaxy team in Germany. And I think we're also going to have a very good relation. So there are two new BRCs. We are one, and there is another, I forgot how it's called, out of Switzerland. We just had a very good call. I think we have very good complementarity on what they want to do. So yes, you should. It's a very vague answer, but yes, you should expect more of this. So just give us the benefit of the doubt in terms of time. We really want to do it. We just need a little bit of time.
Yeah. Yeah, and there are a couple of questions. There are also a couple of questions about community type issues, and you mentioned, you know, that, you know, community is important, and we do have some experience with that. It's very important to me. Please get involved, because the way we're going to make this tool good and useful tool is if we have a lot of feedback on what we're doing well and what we're not doing well and what we need to include. So those are all important things. Go ahead.
There is a LinkedIn channel right now. Also, probably we need to put all of this on the website banner. So see, we don't have basic stuff like this yet. But the channel is there, and just spread the word. And we need your feedback. We need your feedback. I'm going to sell it, you know, for the whole 5 remaining minutes. I can just sit and say that. But we need constructive feedback, in the sense that how and exactly, you know, what exactly do you need, and how exactly you think we should do that. Because, you know, it's like a political discourse. It's easy to complain, but it's difficult to propose actual solution. So what we are trying to, we want some feedback on what, we know what the problems are, but suggest a solution, and then we'll jump on that. There is one comment on that we may be posts most. If you post more of these questions on Discourse, we'll look through them and we'll try to answer as many as we can.
Yeah.
Because in 1 hour, that's impossible to do. Anything else we have there?
Let's see, I'm trying to. There's a lot of like comments that are mixed in here, like the limitation will be genomes and sequencing data.
So what to answer to that, it seems centric on that, but what other, how, So for example, VuePathDB was also genome-centric. I mean, it was gene-centric. And one of the cool things about VuePathDB is that you can do these search strategies where you can, which we'll also implement. But it was also genome-centric inherently. You mean you want to do things in a population-centric way or taxonomy-centric way or, I don't know, what are the centricities are there?
Again, people, there are so many questions about data sets. Another person asked about proteomic data sets. I mean, it's all about, you know, pulling in, you know, we need to know what we need to pull in.
So make available. We have proteomic experience. There is a project not associated with us directly. It's from University of Minnesota. It's called GalaxyP. And that's essentially a whole different project which deals with proteomic data solely. And so they do various cool things, combining proteomic analysis with RNA-seq. And so this can all be pulled in because while we're not the same team, but we're very close to each other, so we collaborate and we can exchange things easily. There is also, for example, I don't know if there are some things like, geographic information can be pulled in here. Probably for some types of infectious disease outbreaks, climate data is important. So all of that is possible, but we need to prioritize. I can promise you that we're going to do everything, but in the end, I'm going to fail. So we need some prioritization here.
Yeah. Let's see. I will mention, so we are very close to the end of time. One person I just want to mention, read out loud, for you, Anton. It says, thank you for taking the time to explain this new resource to us. Sorry, so many in this chat seem pretty negative. I appreciate any options. I disagree that many seem negative. They're just people want to know answers. I appreciate any options, even if some things are just different way to find similar data that's on VuePathDB site. Thanks. And so thank you. I appreciate the
We'll post the recording. We'll have a YouTube channel for this. Sometime next week we'll post that recording so you can.
Yeah, my hope is to get this edited today and probably uploaded over the weekend. And so there should be a link Monday or Tuesday on the BRC website to this thing. And somebody else asked about a link to the Discord site, which I think was answered earlier, but there is also a link to it on the brcanalytics.org website as well.
So. Let me share screen for just one last second to make sure where is that site, because where is that link? Because it's probably...
Let's see.
It's right here. Sorry, it's gonna be right there. So yeah, it's on the front page, and it goes to discourse form. And as you can see, we have some things, but not much yet.
Oh, you clicked on it; it opened in a new tab, and we didn't get to see it. There we go. So yeah, so there's some discussion about basically the way people did things on VuePathDB, which I appreciate people doing that. And I'd like to hear more of it because, again, the way we'll make a tool that's useful is we know what people need to do. So that's it. That's the top of the hour. Thank you, everybody, for attending. We really appreciate this feedback. And like Anton said, we're gonna do these on a fairly regular basis, especially since things are moving very fast right now. Like we said, we've been working on this only a few weeks and we've done a lot and we're going to keep doing more. So
thanks
everybody. Have a good weekend.